Rhianna Jarrett, welcome to the Offaly League of Ireland podcast. How are you?
Not too bad, thanks. How are things?
Great, thanks, Rhianna. Thanks for having a chat with us. Now, you're currently in Belfast in the middle of a Champions League campaign with Wexford Youth Ladies. Just talk us through the 4-1 defeat against Ajax, your goal, which put your team 1-0 up, and in the end, unfortunately, it wasn't enough and you were probably well beaten in the end.
Yeah, it was a game of mixed emotions. I suppose a game of two halves. I think the first half we went in half-time, nil all. We were delighted with ourselves. We had a solid performance. All 11 worked tirelessly, shifting across the pitch, making sure that we tried to eliminate as much space as we could for Ajax. And we were delighted going in at half-time. At half-time, we knew we needed more of the same in the second half. We virtually scored as soon as the second half kicked off. A ball of emotions when that went in. Great celebrations, but unfortunately, we couldn't hold on to that for any length of time. I think they went and won a corner literally straight from tip-off, and they equalised from there. And then I think moments later, they went 2-1 up from there then.
Yeah, I'm just actually watching the goal and the celebration here on the Wexford FC Twitter page at the moment. The goal is great. It's a wide free kick, crossed in. It's a bullet header if ever there was one. Alan Shearer-esque, bang, it goes into the goal. And then you're like sprinting on a curved run and some sort of a shake your hands type celebration with the girls. Tell me about that and scoring in the Champions League.
It was a super ball from Emma Hansbury. She does that week in, week out for us. And I was fortunate enough to get my head on it and steer it in the right direction, and it went in. I think it definitely caught me surprised, never mind the rest of the girls. Kind of went off on a sprint. Emma kind of kept her positioning kind of towards the halfway line, so I seen her and said, look, might as well go celebrate with her, and the rest of the girls followed suit.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. And of course, it's a fantastic emotion to have gone 1-0 up and then in the end to have lost the game 4-1. You must have been quite disappointed. Just explain to listeners and viewers who are unaware that the Women's Champions League works differently to the men's one, and that it's not games every 2 or 3 weeks. It's a group of four in one place, and you play, it's almost like, you know, a group of three matches over 5 or 6 days.
Yeah, so kind of this time of year, there's 10 mini tournaments, as they call it, going on. So there's 10 groups of four hosted throughout Europe, where the winners are guaranteed qualification to the next round of the Champions League, and then there's two best runners up. And I think they go in then to the last 32 with kind of the top seeded teams across Europe. So you play 3 games in the space of 8 days. So we played yesterday, which was Tuesday. We'll now play again Friday. And then our final game will take place on Monday.
Yeah, you're playing Thor KA next match on Friday before finishing the campaign with a great derby, North v South, against Linfield on Monday, who are the hosts of this competition, of course. So what does it mean in terms of hoping now to qualify, given that you've lost to Ajax, who were the favourites to win the group? You now need, obviously, to win on Friday. But if you win both games, what does that mean?
I mean, we obviously have to take our next games into consideration. Our next game is Friday, so we're building towards Thor. Obviously, we're looking to get the win there, and then crown off the tournament then with a win against Linfield. That's kind of the hopes. That's what we're aiming to do. You'd obviously then be hoping that maybe Thor or Linfield could take points off of Ajax, and that would be nice kind of to give us a chance. But I suppose at the minute we're just looking to do the best that we can, concentrate on our own game. If Ajax go on and win the rest of the games, which they will expect to do so, then we'll be hoping to finish second. And who knows, we could end up as one of the best second teams. We don't really know until the end of the tournament.
Yeah. Rhianna, just explain to me the Women's Champions League experience overall, what it's like to be an Irish footballer playing in the Champions League, because we've seen in the men's side of the game, Dundalk and Cork in recent years, you know, trying to make it to that level and not quite getting there, but getting into the Europa League group stage in Dundalk's case, and the fairy tale stories we've heard. For you guys, what's it been like?
I mean, this is, as a club, this is our third time in the Champions League kind of qualifiers. For me, it's my first time playing, but it's an unbelievable experience. Yesterday, walking out with your friends, you play and train it week in, week out. It's the highest level in club football. It's something that not everybody gets to experience. And we're just reeling it. Obviously, we would have liked somewhere a little bit farther than Belfast, but look, the weather's like home, the food's like home, so we're staying in a nice hotel here, so we can't complain too much. I mean, we got to play against Ajax yesterday. Who can turn around and say that they played against Ajax? I mean, it's not something that every Irish player can turn around and say. Irish teams have done well previously. Like, Piemont, a good few years back before the National League started, they played PSG, I think it was, in the last 32. I think it was Shells. They got through as well. They played against Bristol in the next round. So we came into it thinking, you know, if they can do it, why can't we do it?
Yeah, of course, Andy. Yeah. You've got 2 games left, as we mentioned. And just In this week, Rhianna, of course, with the women's hockey team finishing second in the World Cup, getting a silver medal. We had a couple of the girls in the studio on Off the Ball AM this morning and Off the Ball last night. And, you know, we spoke to their head coach, Graham Shaw, just about women's sport and what Irish teams performing well can do for women's sport and as role models and stuff. And we've had the rugby team, international women's soccer team, very, very close to making the World Cup playoffs as well. We've got Katie Taylor, you know, world champion already, 10 professional wins in a row. You've got your team playing in the Champions League. Women's sport in the country at the minute seems to be in quite a good place.
Yeah, it's definitely grown and it's great to see. I mean, the success with the hockey girls there only last week was fantastic. You've seen throughout social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, the whole country got behind them. It's not really, you wouldn't call it the most popular sport in Ireland, but the Irish are great for when any Irish person, whether it's an individual or a team, are successful or doing well in a tournament, the whole country will get behind them and back them. And it was great to see for the hockey girls. I mean, to come out of a World Cup with a silver medal, it's phenomenal. Phenomenal and fair play to all of them, the players, their backroom staff, everyone involved. It was great to see. And it's only going to encourage kids in their own sport. If they can see people that are local to them, close to them, being successful at a high level, it's kind of why can't they sort of a thing. And hopefully women's sport in Ireland will continue to do so.
Rhianna, final two questions. From your point of view, you've had three serious knee injuries, three anterior cruciate ligament operations. You're back playing in the Champions League. And of course, you've recently returned for Ireland in the 1-0 defeat to Norway in the World Cup qualifiers. The girls in green play Northern Ireland in the final qualifier at the end of this month, a game I'm sure you'll be hopeful to be involved in. Just give us a background to those serious injuries that you had. And to be playing football at any level is a great achievement, given those, never mind the Champions League and the World Cup qualifiers.
Yeah, I think I done my first one back in 2013. Would have been my last under 19 game in the international setup. So kind of since then, the last couple of years, they've been a bit stop start in regards to injuries. I think I've been injured more often than not. I've been back playing now since the end of June last year. Feel that I'm finally coming back into myself, scoring a few goals with the youths in the Women's National League, and I was fortunate enough, as you said, to be back in the international squad for the Norway team. Obviously looking at hopefully being in the squad for the Northern Ireland game. But if not, I will definitely be looking towards the European qualifier starting next September. I have a lot to do in regards to my own game, my own fitness, my own shape. If I do want to be a serious contender for the international team, I know that, but at the minute, I'm just happy to be back playing, and obviously to be sitting here playing in the Champions League after all those injuries, it's definitely worth it. I mean, all the times you're in the gym by yourself, running by yourself, it's something that has to be done, but it's not seen. So you know that the important bit is getting back on the pitch, and luckily I've been able to do that three times, and hopefully that's the back of all the injuries now for me.
What a huge shame it is. The Irish team and this match against Northern Ireland won't be nothing on the line as such in terms of trying to make the World Cup or finishing second for that playoff group. Rhianna, just finally, and I was speaking to a couple of people about you before we had a chat and about those injuries and how good you are, and you know, they both said that if the injuries hadn't happened, she'd definitely be playing professional football across the water like a number of your Irish teammates are. Now that you're back fit and scoring goals in the Champions League, is that an aim for you to you know, if possible, achieve a full-time career in the UK?
Yeah, kind of. Has always been thought about it. Obviously, with the injuries, I've never really had time to have a serious think about it. But if the opportunity came calling, I think it definitely would be something that I wouldn't be able to say no to. Obviously, you'd have to make sure it's right for me individually and personally. But look, my goals from the start of the season were to do the best I can for the Wexford youths, help us do the best we can as a team, and ultimately finish out the season kind of was the main goal, because it's something that I haven't done since, I think it was the 2012-2013 season for Wexford youths. So you're talking 5 years that I haven't completed the full season. So that's kind of my aim at the minute. And then I'll reevaluate come November, kind of building in towards the start of next season.
That's the voice of Rhianna Jarrett, Wexford FC player and Ireland international, talking all things Champions League ahead of the game on Friday against Tor, and also playing against Linfield in their final Champions League group game later in the week. Rhianna, thanks a million. Best of luck. We'll speak to you soon.
Thank you. Bye.
That's just about it for episode 26 of the Off the Ball League of Ireland podcast. Thank you so much for listening, and to all of our guests, Rhianna Jarrett, as you just heard, as well as Gary Cronin, Graeme Kelly and the Cove manager Stephen Henderson, who has just about recovered from his hangover and is getting ready to lead his team in the FAI Cup against Dundalk this coming Friday. If you listen to the audio version, we're going to now bring an interview with the Skerries Town manager Alan Sweeney ahead of their match against Waterford FC this coming Saturday in the FAI Cup. If you're watching the video version, that's it, but the full audio version right now is in the podcast section of offtheball.com, and we will chat to you next Wednesday. Thanks as always to the fantastic Raf Diallo behind the scenes, just back from China. We missed him a lot. He was actually seen recently dancing his heart away in an Irish nightclub as well. So if you check out Team 33 on the Off The Ball website, you might find out a bit more about that. And also the views of Arsenal under their new gaffer as well. We'll see you next Wednesday, folks. Thank you. Bye-bye.